Welcome, everyone. My name is Catherine Hayhoe. I am a climate scientist, chief scientist for the Nature Conservancy, and a professor at Texas Tech University in the United States. I want to welcome you to this session, which will highlight two of the COP presidency's flagship science programs, the Global Climate Risk Assessment and the Futures We Want. Over the last few decades, science has painted a very clear and a very grim picture of what is already happening to our world. Climate change is no longer a future issue. It is no longer a distant issue. Climate impacts are here and now, and no matter where we live, and no matter what we care about, we are already being affected by them. We see that temperatures are rising. Rainfall patterns are shifting. Oceans are rising. And perhaps most significantly, climate change is loading the weather dice against us. Wherever we live, it's as if we have a pair of dice, and we always have a chance of naturally rolling a double six. A heat wave, a storm, a drought, a wildfire. But as the world warms decade by decade, it's as if climate change is sneaking in and taking one of the numbers on our dice and turning it into a six as well. And then taking another number and turning it into a seven. And then all of a sudden we look around and we say, how can we be having 3 500-year flood events in 3 years? It's because climate change is altering the probability and the risk of many of our extreme weather events that affect us. They affect us economically, they affect our health, they affect the security of our water and our homes and our food. Today, thanks to attribution science, we can even put a number on how much worse climate change is making a given event. Whether it has increased the amount of rain that fell during a hurricane by 40%, whether it has magnified the damages from a cyclone by 300%, whether it increased the probability of the heat wave that devastated Western North America by over 150%, or over 150 times. We know what's happening today, but we also know that what we don't know may be the most concerning part of it. We are truly conducting an unprecedented experiment with the only planet we have. Temperature is increasing faster today than any time in the history of our civilization on the planet, and that's why it matters to us. The planet has been warmer and cooler before, but not with 8 billion humans on it. Not with all of our agricultural land allocated. Not with all of our water resources spoken for. Not with 2/3 of the largest cities in the world within a meter of sea level. It's not about saving the planet. It is quite literally about saving us. Us and many of the other living things that share this home with us. As far back as we can go into the paleoclimate record, we can't see any example of this much carbon going into the atmosphere this quickly. There are certainly times of rapid change, but even then it was happening over slower timescales than it's happening today. That's why our experiment is truly unprecedented. And what concerns us, as a climate scientist, I'm often asked, what keeps you up at night? And, you know, I could fill probably a whole notebook with the list of those things. But at the very top of what keeps us up at night is the potential for unpleasant surprises, which you may know as tipping points. Points at which the climate system transitions into a new state that is essentially irreversible, especially over human timescales. We don't know when those will happen, but we do know, number one, that they have happened in the past. And we do know, number two, that the further and faster we push our planet beyond its current condition, the more likely it is that we will reach and surpass one or more of those tipping points. The risks to avoid are clear, but the science also offers this hope. And the hope is that our future is in our hands. Climate is changing today entirely because of human emissions of heat-trapping gases. Natural factors are minuscule compared to the influence of humans on climate today, and in fact, long term, would point us in a gradually cooling direction. Instead, we are warming faster and faster, but that means that we have agency. We have an unprecedented agency to make decisions that will shape our future. As the IPCC says in their 1.5 degree report, every year matters, every bit of warming matters, every choice matters, and every action matters. That sense of agency is incredible, and it gives us that hope. Hope is not the guarantee of a better future. Hope is the small chance of something better. And what will determine whether that happens, whether it's realized or actualized, it's us. We are the ones who will determine what the future holds. When I say we, I do not only mean climate scientists. I do not only mean delegates to COP. I do not only mean those who work on climate full time. I mean everyone, because climate change is an everything issue. Climate change affects our food, the water we drink and the air we breathe, the places we live, our safety, our security, and most of all, our health. Climate change affects all of us, but it affects some more than others. And that is why climate change is profoundly unfair. It disproportionately affects those who are already marginalized, who already live in poverty, who already live in unsafe conditions, women and children, especially in low-income countries, populations that already lack sufficient food or a safe place to live, Indigenous peoples who have already lost so much, Black and brown neighborhoods in North America, where I live. Climate change is profoundly unfair. But at the same time, climate solutions hold the promise of a better future for us all, but especially a better future for those who lack the resources that we so often take for granted today. It isn't only about what we are trying to avoid, it is also about what we are heading towards. And climate change is the hurdle that we must overcome in order to reach that better future. A future that is better than today, that has clean air to breathe. Remember the first days of the pandemic during the lockdown when there was the pictures of the blue sky circulating on social media? A world where the skies are blue everywhere, where there's ample food, where there's clean water, sanitation, access to energy, basic jobs. If this sounds familiar, it should, because these are the Sustainable Development Goals. And down at number 13 in the SDGs, we have climate action. But if I could, and no offense intended by this, if I could, I would actually take out number 13, because the only reason we care about climate action is because it affects our ability to eliminate poverty and hunger, to provide basic health care, quality education, jobs, sanitation, clean water. Climate change is a threat multiplier that challenges our ability to meet every single one of the Sustainable Development Goals. So I would put it sort of as an overarching bow above the Sustainable Development Goals, something that we have to reach beyond in order to achieve that better future. We know that the solutions to climate change have benefits tomorrow in terms of carbon emission reductions, but they also have benefits today. Solutions like greening our cities, clean energy, smart agriculture, protecting our coastlines. They give us safer places to live, cleaner air to breathe, reduce the risk of disease. How do we get there? How do we identify these win-win-win solutions that provide benefits today as well as tomorrow? We do so through developing realistic policies, collaborative solutions that don't start with the scientists. They start with the people who understand the issues the most, who are most affected by them, working together with concerned citizens across society, as you'll hear during the panels today. All working together because climate change is a human issue. So we work for a more just, a more sustainable, a more equitable, and a more resilient future. Why? Because this issue matters to every single one of us. Again, no matter who we are, no matter what we care about, climate change is affecting us, and climate solutions benefit us. So it's my pleasure to introduce this video from the Woodwell Institute that talks about why risk assessments are so important. The first panel will be talking about the assessing the risk, what is the hurdle that we must overcome, and why. And then the second panel will pivot to looking at what are the futures that we choose. Let's start the video.
Climate risk is really all of the issues that are related to the various ways the climate is changing around us. It really all comes down to the trade-offs between going along as we are, business as usual, and the damage that, say, extreme weather is going to do, the damage that rising sea levels are going to do, that stronger storms are going to do, and then look to the future and see, you know, how can we do better?
If we understand climate risk better, we can prepare for it better, we can make our societies and our cities and our populations more resilient. But understanding climate risk is also important for motivating action.
As it stands, we currently have less than a 5% chance of staying below 2 degrees worth of warming, after which runaway climate change could kick in. The impacts of climate change are like nothing decision makers have had to consider before. And the challenge of presenting robust science versus accessible information for time-constrained decision makers is acute.
We worked with the COP26 Presidency and the British Foreign Office, specifically their Science and Innovation Network, to hold workshops in 13 of the G20 countries. Given what we know about the scope and scale of the problem, there should be urgency to mitigate. But we haven't seen that, and we're trying to understand why.
This workshop exists to try to figure out how to deliver the right message. So at least it is acknowledged as a problem. We're sitting on a wealth of knowledge. We have all the science down, it's just not getting delivered. And not getting delivered means not enough policymakers are making the right decision.
Being able to incorporate and include all spheres of society to get their perspective of the lived experiences that exist within the communities that we live in, to be able to draft policies and implement policies that are very relatable, very applicable to the daily lives that we live.
It was surprising to me how many themes were consistent in every single workshop. One of those was the need to localize and customize risk assessments to be very relevant to specific geographies or specific sectors. Another takeaway was the need to co-design risk assessments. That came up in almost every single workshop in one way or another. The need to get policymakers involved at the beginning and make sure there's an audience for the risk assessment before it's even begun. Another very interesting takeaway was the need to pair risk assessments with solutions. We heard again and again that if risk assessments are presented on their own, they are depressing, they are overwhelming sometimes, and if they're not paired with productive pathways, then they're going to be pushed to the side.
Understanding and analyzing and deeper studying climate change risks and channeling this information to decision makers, both in the private and the public sector, is fundamental to design both the public policies for the future and also to design the future of the economic decisions that would bring accuracy and more economic success to the private sector in the years to come.
I think what is perhaps getting more traction now is that we're able to connect the dots between just saying, you know, we're going to see more of these kinds of events happen, putting numbers on them in terms of money. And that is what policymakers understand.
Now that we've come through these workshops, we understand how to make climate risk assessments better. We understand how to make them more useful. We understand how to make them more actionable. We understand how to make them more relevant. I hope that better climate risk assessments help political leaders really understand the severity of the challenge we're facing. This is a crisis, and they should act like it's a crisis, and we need to figure out a way to deliver this information in a way that explains that.
Our first panel addresses the risks. And as I introduce each panelist, if you could come and take your seat beginning over here. Dr. Elena Maneyankova is the Deputy Secretary General of the WMO, the World Meteorological Organization. She is a geographer who specializes in hydrology and meteorology. Tandy Mappe-Villadsen is the humanitarian diplomacy coordinator for the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies. She leads locally led action, climate change adaptation, and resilience building. She's a Zambian national, a trained journalist, and a former UN diplomat. Welcome. Nick Bridge is the UK Special Representative for Climate Change. He was previously the permanent representative of the UK to the OECD and served as chief economist at the Foreign and Commonwealth Office and head of Global Economy Department. Thank you. Yes, right there. And our final panelist is Professor Lee Young, Deputy Director General of the ICCSD of Tsinghua University. He is the Executive Vice President of the Institute of Climate Change and Sustainable Development and Director of their Laboratory of Low Carbon Energy. And his research addresses energy and climate, including low carbon development strategies and transition pathways. Welcome, please. Our first question, and we have a question for each panelist, is this. Dr. Mayan-Inkova, what are the climate risks that you think should be on the radar of the heads of government but are not? Yes, so push the button, and when you see the red, okay. It's on. There we go.
All right, Kandri, thanks for the question. And I know I promised that I have a direct answer to your question, and I will. But your introduction and all these videos which you present actually triggered something in my mind. In just a few minutes, I will tell you what I mean. The WMO, the one of the oldest organizations in the world, we actually exist almost 150 years, are always dealing with the risks and probabilities. That is the core business. When we do weather forecast, we always deal with risks. And all Met services, meteorological and hydrological services in the world are dealing with that. And it was extremely challenging 50 years ago because probabilities was not something people understood. It was just like rain or not, or how much and where. So, but increasingly, this notion of risk and options and probabilities are becoming the part of our life, and it makes life of Met services easier. WMO does issue climate state report global for more than 40 years. It's now became like something which everyone knows here at COP. Every year we provide indication and detection of climate indicators. But 5 years ago, we understood it's not sufficient just talk about physical changes. We need to provide information and so what happens. So the way we attack this challenge, we collected statistical information and reports from the sister agency in the United Nations system, from World Health Organization, from Migration Office, from Food and Agriculture Organization, and we started putting this information together. It provides completely different perspective, what happens with the physical climate and what else happens in the different areas of the work of our sister agency. This is still not proper risk assessment, this is still not proper attribution, but this provides a wealth of information that connections are happening. A little later, 2015, we all celebrated Paris Agreement. It took 25 years to develop this Paris Agreement. We were, yes, we have Paris Agreement and 1.5 is still possible. However, you rightly said that SDGs, Catherine, SDG 13 is not the one. Climate affects everything. 2 months ago, WMO, 2 months ago, this September, WMO released a report of assessment of climate risks on each and every SDG. It is still global, it is still general. We need to go much down to regional level, to country level, but this is right step forward. Now look at IPCC reports. The science is becoming increasingly skillful in explaining what will happen and what is level of confidence and what is level of probabilities of certain risks. The latest three reports, special reports of IPCC on ocean cryosphere, 1.5 climate, and land degradation, they were made by all three working groups together, physical science, adaptation, and mitigation together. This provides unique information to understand what if. So the current assessment working group one report already released with the wealth of risk information. I really liked the report you provided as a background to this session. It's Chatham House risk assessment report. But I think it's not just the one unique in the world. There are some others which exist. I'm based in Switzerland. I'm also Swiss. And there is a Swiss National Climate Assessment Report, 2019. It is done on the basis of CMIP models. And it's very easy to read, to policymakers, to any user, to any practitioner. It's very simple. It says what already happened, what will happen in 1.5, what will happen in 2, what's the difference, what are the risks, how high they are, and what to do. So important is to provide also mitigation effect. If you take action, how we can make things better, how we can mitigate risk, and what residual risk remains. So from WMO perspective, we are absolutely keen to find any way to provide ability to every country to have such report for themselves. So if I go to head of government, so my main message for head of government would be, care about the people. You said every bit of warming matters, every bit of warming increases the risk. For WMO, every life matters. We are seeing people dying every day. I mean, this is becoming extraordinary. Last 50 years, the number of hazards increased by five times more. But we have managed to save three times more lives than 50 years ago because we have good early warning systems. And today, one third of vulnerable population in the world have no access to any warning systems at all. We need to deal with this now because they are not ready. So the risk assessment is becoming part of the culture in WMO and with all our partners and here in the COP. Risk assessment needs to go across all the government institutions. WMO issued report on sustainable development goals, it's global, but what we realized, it's not sufficient that one agency in the country who is in charge of climate change deals with this. It's really essential to have connections with all the sectors. It's all interconnected. Several years ago, WMO had a global framework for climate services, and one of the good stories of this report is national frameworks of climate services now actioning in many countries are doing exactly that. They are putting health agency together with water agency together. So for the head of state, risks are there. Every bit of warming matters. Every bit of warming increases risks of losing life. So every government has a responsibility to protect people, to make them safe. I would also pay attention on the water stress. It's a big elephant in the room, which we are not talking enough. And I could speak another half an hour about that. So water stress is there. It's there. And WMO does have tools and methodologies to do the risk assessment based on real data and real simulation. For tipping points, I would not speak enough not to exhaust my time. You can ask more questions. So, but just for tipping points, not everything is clear, but the risk of tipping points should not be ruled out. It's not yet clear, but still bear it in mind. And World Climate Research Program is now initiating the project of tipping points model intercomparison to provide more body science for IPCC future assessments. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. I like that addition. So it's not only a matter of every year matters, every action matters, every life matters.
Yes.
And why do we care about a warming planet? If the average temperature of the planet were increasing by 1 or 2 or even 3 or 4 degrees, but that was the only thing that were happening, it would be a scientific curiosity. The reason we care about it is because, like you said, it directly affects lives. It affects every aspect of life, human and non-human life on this planet. And that's why these assessments are so important, because what is unique about humans is we have the ability to understand what we're doing and to change our ways. So that leads me to my second question for Ms. Philadson, which is, can you give us some examples where climate risk information has informed and motivated and driven ambitious action and response?
Excellent. Thank you so much, particularly for the very compelling opening to this discussion, and to Elena as well. Many thanks for emphasizing the aspect on focusing on people and lives. This is the heart of the work of the Red Cross. To give you a picture, I'll just add to the video that we saw. What we witnessed on the Africa region last year and this year has been compounding risks. You saw images of young Red Cross volunteers out in communities, in the villages where flooding had taken place, lifting young children, helping women with the very few assets that they have to take them to safer grounds. They're wearing masks. They don't have the right protective gear in some instances. The current situation is catastrophic already for the Africa region. and for the small island states, as you've heard in most of the conversations. And so the science and risk assessment for us is critical to save lives, as Elena put it. It is critical because it is about life and death at the moment. I know we're all trying to hang on to hope, but it's quite dire and dramatic out there. The situation in communities that are most exposed to climate risks is dire, and that percentage that we're looking at, the 1.5 is already bad enough for some communities. And so when you bring in COVID, add another layer of conflict, and the whole climate risks that we're facing, that image I just paint is actually almost a soft aspect that I'm presenting. The consequences are dire. The International Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies is a network of national Red Cross societies that are anchored within national boundaries. Each country, all of us here, have a national society in our countries. And what our work involves is providing that last mile connectivity between the science, the evidence that is present now, and the action on the ground, the solutions that you spoke about. So for us, it's not enough that we have so many assessments and evidence that are sitting on our tables and we can eloquently speak about them. Ours is to ensure that we're translating the evidence and the science that's available out there to protect lives, to mitigate against severe impacts of climate change and the impacts that we're seeing at community level. Talking of ambition, the science and the work that we do, for example, with the Meteorological Department, it's a critical partner for us at country level. And I'll give examples of the Kenya Red Cross, Togo, Mali, Zambia, Mozambique, Ethiopia, where we have had to set up emergency operation centers to work with meteorological departments to translate that scientific information we're getting on weather predictions to be used for early warning and early action. Now, this is where that conversation becomes critical for us on climate finance, because having the evidence and the science, again, is not enough if we're not able to translate that from the documents we have into actionable response on the ground. Now, that gap that we speak about in climate finance means that when the evidence is there and we're not able to apply that evidence to prevent the severe impacts of a projected flooding situation, droughts, Madagascar is unraveling right before us. Mm-hmm. It's being called potentially the first climate change-induced famine. This is not something that happened suddenly. We have known this information. So where do we draw and close that gap on the existing science and the prevention of severe disasters? Now, gloomy as it may sound, there are good examples out there on how we as the Red Cross take pride in the work that we do with the volunteers that I give. Yes, you know, deep in the waters up to there, but when that young volunteer gets home, they are fulfilled because they have saved lives. They've saved a woman, they've saved a child's life, but also they are contributing to making that connection happen between, unfortunately, the science that has existed, but late action in some instances. The climate finance aspect is important because what it does for us is to prepare our national societies to have the right mechanisms and systems in place to respond when the disasters are happening, because one spectrum of this conversation is obviously failing. We have to call it what it is. We are failing to use sometimes the information and the science that is out there to action to prevent loss of life, to prevent loss of livelihoods, and so investing again into capacities at national level where we see governments and partners on the ground are able to put systems in place to prevent the disasters that we're seeing, to save those lives, and set up mechanisms, whether it's emergency operation centers, whether it's a contingency plans, kicking in anticipatory action through focus-based financing, where we get the information, we are ready to say, okay, fine, drought is coming to Madagascar. We've known this. How do we use that information to action work around access to water, which you speak about? Water stresses are immense, and climate disasters for us are also a lot about how we are managing water resources around us. Food security, health, gender-based violence. We've seen that tremendously spike in the last 2 years because of the pandemic. But that's all to do with the stresses around us. And so moving forward, we are optimistic that conversations that are happening here today around climate finance, around the mitigation agenda, that might seem a little bit sometimes detached when you are on the ground. It is a critical conversation for us because a failure to mitigate means more disastrous consequences for the Red Cross and those people that we're working with who are our core partners. They are not beneficiaries. They are core partners in decision making, in policy development, but most importantly, that last mile connectivity on translating the available science into action that prevents loss of life, loss of livelihoods, but strengthens people's ability to live in the climate that we're now living with.
Thank you so much. Climate finance is a simple term, a little bit wonky, but it's one that ultimately relates directly to real humans, and you have put a human face on that term and shown us very clearly exactly why that is so important. 1.5 and 2 degrees are not magic thresholds. They do not protect us from all the impacts. People are already suffering today, and that is why it is not only about reducing our emissions, but it is also about providing those resources that you expressed the need for so eloquently. Thank you. Turning now to Mr. Bridge. We all have responsibility, but those who are elected to make decisions and to represent people have greater responsibility. How can we improve the assessment and delivery of this climate risk information to those who have the ability to make those decisions?
Well, thank you so much, Professor Hayhoe, and everybody else who's here. Let me just first say a more sort of personal thing about making common cause between public officials, civil servants, and scientists and innovators. And I've just come from, you know, our regular very early morning meeting with the presidency team, the negotiating team, the people doing the diplomacy and all of that. And it is such a committed, you know, creative, you know, relentlessly determined, sort of resilient group. And I think I see that a lot in the science community as well. So, you know, I really, you know, often it's a bit hidden behind the news headlines just how determined and passionate and committed, you know, my colleagues are, and I'm sort of very inspired to be, you know, around them. So I hope that's helpful. And part of this is, you know, the effort today to have a science and innovation focus at COP that kind of runs in parallel in this important second week. So it's a real pleasure to have this opportunity and get on to answering the question. There's a lot going on today that I hope is encouraging around that connection between the science and the policy. Look at our gov.uk announcements, just to summarize some of the announcements today around mission innovation and the annual climate risk assessment that we now want to see. Adaptation and resilience is a huge focus, and more adaptation research and adaptation research alliance. Particular thanks in the recent months, as the colleague said, there's a lot of this going on around the world, but two processes I've been involved with the Royal Institute for International Affairs led risk assessment for leaders effort this year, which tried to sort of start to take the science and make it impactful for leaders at the top sort of political table. And also Woodwell, who have been convening these risk assessment conversations with important actors all around the world. And I've just been very inspired to see those conversations happening. So this is one thing. It is now happening that we're taking the predictive science and we're moving basically into that risk assessment space where we are much more able to talk about the known unknowns and the unknown unknowns and all of that, and give leaders the kind of information they need in a very busy daily inbox to prioritize this to stay with the long-term and of course, near-term and immediate risks of this, and to enable leaders to think holistically in a world where they're pulled in many different directions every day, with 10 or 20 things, you know, landing on their desk in the morning. This remains a coherent story for them. I mean, one way, as I say, I've seen that is the way that we have moved to the space around risk. I was greatly criticized a few years ago, 10 years ago, for the analogy that I made around, you know, if your car had a 1 or 2% chance of brake failure, would you get in the car? Well, nobody would get in that car. 1 or 2% chance of brake failure, no one would get in the car. And yet we're here talking about a 50% chance or a 66% chance of retaining temperatures below a level that is catastrophic for humans, for coral, for life on Earth. So I think we just have to keep pressing leaders to really understand the speed with which, I mean, two things, with which issues are aggregating. Because at the moment, you know, this is the whole world system. The complexity of it needs to be understood. And it's very hard for our models to look at that aggregation of all these different risks, which is likely to be a risk greater than the sum of those individual parts. So the aggregation and then the integration. And it's been a great sort of pleasure to see the way at this COP that nature has been brought much more centrally into the conversation. And the wider SDGs are in that conversation, because if we just tackle the climate risk, we'll miss the wider SDGs that are all with us. We've talked about some of them, water, food systems, and so on. So, you know, I think that that sort of shift decisively to sort of the risk-based approach, the simplification of the meta risks, but also very specifically in specific places where we now see the impacts and are living the impacts. We can't just say it's a hypothetical thing that's somewhere down the line. We can talk about it impacting now. And supposed to wrap up, you know, the storytelling element, and whether that's, you know, poetic or, you know, prose storytellers or policy storytellers or scientific storytellers, you know, this is inviolably, you know, a story about a healthier, a more nature-rich, a more secure, a fairer and a more prosperous world. And the counterfactual is really not worth thinking about. So we take these very big risks that we do not shy away from talking about, but they need not be packaged in the media as doom and gloom or whatever. They are packaged as serious, grown-up risks that we can then tackle together.
Thank you for that emphasis on the dual nature of this panel, which is the risks, but also the potential in the future. And the way we tell the stories is key to where we go. So digging in a little bit further on how do we transition this information, how do we get this information to governments, to leaders who can use it to make decisions? Dr. Zheng, what are the most effective processes or mechanisms that you have found to get climate risk information to the governments who need to make the decisions?
Okay, thank you for the question. So I come from Tsinghua University. So my institute called Institute of Climate Change and Sustainable Development. And my background is a technical person. I'm a technical professor. And I don't talk much about this risk assessment, but I just have some plain ideas. So on the video we have seen just, I found the word PIA, the risk assessment with solution. I think that's a very important strategy. So in the reality, I think government officials have terms, and they want and they can do what within their reach. So I think we should for the information we provide, it should not only, I think it's good, but it's not only to provide the aggregated data, aggregated description about damage, about the consequences. So some deep dive cases, deep analysis. To touch in the mind is important. So for example, for this year, there's a lot of weather extremes. So I think that's what we want to prevent. So what I think a detailed analysis, detailed description about what are the damage level, why it happened, and what measures, what shortcomings we have with our system policy, especially with our infrastructure, and how can we prevent that? I think that that kind of information will be very touching and effective to reach the heads of government. And second, that's my own thought. I would like to see that. So pair the risk assessment with an overall climate policy and the strategy. So to do risk assessment, that's not that's a process. That's some help means, but that's not our ultimate purpose. Our ultimate purpose is to prevent them. So in this way, so risk assessment can be effective only when the country has an overall strategy and are determined to go in this way to deal with climate change. Then risk assessment is one dimension that can be, I would say that, included in the overall strategy and can be conducted. So that's a direct response to your question.
Thank you so much for that. It's clear that while we know that Arctic sea ice is melting and glaciers in Antarctica are calving, the granular information at the local to regional scale is absolutely essential. So you have heard how understanding how climate change affects our water resources, the safety of our homes, the availability of our food, and the future of our country. That is what matters. These regional assessments are so important. The UK has completed recently a national adaptation plan. My home country of Canada released theirs last year. I've served myself as a lead author on the US National Climate Assessment now for four different cycles. The granularity of information, bringing it down to the level of the city, the province, the state, the department, the country is essential. But so many countries lack the basic resources, lack the basic weather observations, lack the information and the expertise to connect these. And so investing in these risk assessments so we understand what risks we face, we can, as you pointed out very clearly, we can prepare for those risks. We know, if we know what's coming, we can prepare for them, is absolutely essential. It is something that we have not done enough of yet, but we must. Because in the words of a fellow scientist, John Holdren, we have three choices. We can mitigate, we can adapt, or we can suffer, and we are going to do some of each. The only question is how much, because the more we reduce our emissions, the less we will have to adapt to and the less suffering there will be. Please join me in thanking this panel. As I mentioned at the beginning, there's two sides to this coin. The first side is the risks that we face, but the second is the future that we want. So this leads us into our second panel session, where we will talk about how we can change the way that we work on climate, as well as the opportunities and both the immediate short-term, as well as the long-term benefits of a net zero world. This has been showcased through an exciting project called The Futures We Want that brought together academics and citizens from Brazil, Jamaica, India, Kenya, the UK, and the Arabian Peninsula to create visions of a thriving net zero world. And this next video highlights the results of that project.
Net zero and climate resilience. This is what we must achieve by 2050 to secure a safe and thriving future for the world. But to get there, we need robust strategies and urgent action. It helps to ask two fundamental questions: what is achievable and what is desirable? As part of the Futures We Want project, that's exactly what we've done. A global partnership of scientists and citizens collaborated to build visions of a net zero future, one that people actually want to live in.
We must reverse land degradation in India and improve our soil health.
I'd like to see more sustainable technologies to produce food with lower greenhouse gas emissions. We need a more energy-efficient way to improve cooling capacity and withstand heat stress.
Experts from six regions across the world came together to identify the science and innovation that will make this future happen. How planting 1 hectare of mangroves on the Jamaican coast could be worth $2,500 every year in storm protection, helping safeguard the livelihoods that depend on tourism. How wind, solar, and biofuels can turn Kenya into a clean energy powerhouse, not only meeting the needs of homes and businesses, but generating income for economic development. And how homes in the UK can use heat pumps and green hydrogen technologies to break their reliance on natural gas. The evidence and opportunities of a resilient net zero world were then discussed with local people in each region, and they told us about the future they want.
I'd like to see green cities with more use of renewable resources.
Global and local management of water needs to be more integrated.
By 2050, I expect to have installed lots of low-carbon technologies into my home.
This combination of science and the voices of citizens gives us these visions of what the future could be, where farmers in India are using traditional organic composting techniques to enhance soil quality and store more carbon, where the Arabian Peninsula is a more livable region with fewer emissions thanks to smart cities, vertical farming and solar energy. And the growth of sustainable farming technologies in Brazil is increasing yields whilst reducing waste and emissions, benefiting both the ecosystem and improving food security. Now, it's up to us, all of us. These regional visions require a global effort, multidisciplinary collaboration to inform resilient net zero strategies, ambitious commitment from governments, businesses, and financial institutions to accelerate climate action. Imagine a resilient, sustainable world, guided by experts, chosen by people. The futures we want are achievable. The futures we want are desirable. The futures we want start now.
The risks of climate change are evident to so many today. I live in the United States, where 70% of people are already worried about climate change. In my home country of Canada and in the UK, it's more than 75% of people. 83% of mothers are worried. 84% of young people in 10 countries are worried about climate change. But when people are surveyed, often they feel hopeless and helpless. They don't know what to do. As you've seen from this video, though, a transition to a net zero future is possible. The desire for change is evident, and the solutions are all around us. They include brand new cutting-edge technologies, ancient techniques that have been practiced for centuries, and new systems and new ways of living that will be commonplace in a net zero world, giving all of us enormous benefits in terms of our health, our economy, jobs, our personal welfare, and more. So I want to welcome to the stage this next panel to talk about the futures that we want. And as I introduce each of you, if you could come forward and take your seat, starting with this one right here. Our first panelist is Dr. Emily Shuckburgh, who is the director of Cambridge Zero. She's a professor of environmental data science at the University of Cambridge, the lead academic on this project, and she will provide the scientific perspective to the panel. Hanna Al-Shahimi is the head of the Office of the UAE's Special Envoy for Climate Change. Her country was featured in this project, and Hanna will aim to provide a perspective from a senior policymaker of what these solutions look like and how they can be implemented. Welcome. Susan Nakyung Lee is an organizer with the Global Climate Assembly. She's an inspiring young person who's part of a group that's organizing this assembly with the aim of providing insight into the role that citizen participation can play and must play, and is frankly essential in policymaking. Our final panelist is Jabri Ibrahim, who's a climate connector from Africa and a United Nations climate champion. A citizen participant for this project, who's also part of the Champions Network and specializes in youth engagement on climate. It is so important to hear from voices, not just across society, but across from all age ranges, because of course, this world is the world that young people will inherit. And they have a greater stake than any of us in ensuring that it is livable and vibrant and full of all the opportunities that this project describes. So our first question is for Dr. Shukro, and you can just push that button there to turn your microphone on when you're ready. Tell us a bit more about this project. We saw some about it in the video, but tell us a bit more, and why is it so important in your experience to bring academics together with citizens to talk about our future?
Well, thank you. So the Futures We Want project was a really genuinely exciting and inspiring collaboration, a collaboration between the countries that you saw in the video, India, Brazil, Jamaica, Kenya, Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, and the UK, to create visions of a hopeful, optimistic future, of a climate-resilient net zero future specifically for each of those different regions. And as you saw in the video, there were really two elements to that. There was understanding what is achievable, and for that we brought together in-country experts, academic experts, supported by researchers from the University of Cambridge, to identify some of the innovations that are possible to help create those better futures. And then we took that information to a really broad group of citizens in each of those countries to turn those ideas into, if you like, windows of what a desirable future might be. So combining together those citizens' hopes and fears for the future into creating a picture of what the world might look like specifically in each of those different regions. So you already heard some examples in the video, but just to give you a few more of the real richness of information that we put together as part of this project. In Kenya, we explored the potential use of more drought-resistant crops and of empowering local communities to conserve their ecological assets. In Jamaica, we looked at how we could restore and protect Jamaica's coastal and marine habitats, promoting protection from erosion and storm damage, improving fish stocks, and also supporting tourism. In India, we looked at how support for local renewable generation, especially solar coupled together with battery and hydrogen storage, could give rural communities more autonomy, but at the same time promoting green jobs and supporting a just transition. In Brazil, we looked at the use of forest-friendly farming techniques to balance food security, economic growth, and environmental protection. In Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates, we looked at how to spur a new clean energy revolution at the same time as supporting a circular economy. And in the UK, and in fact every region we looked at, there was a real emphasis on 15-minute neighborhoods. How can we design our cities and towns in a way that the services can be accessible by walking and cycling, promoting more sustainable, healthier lifestyles? So in each instance, whether it was looking at our food, our land, our water, our energy use, our built environment, there were real inspiring stories of a hopeful future that were co-produced and co-created in partnerships, bringing in the academic evidence base, but really importantly, also drawing on local knowledge and local solutions to create visions of a future that we all really do want.
I love that. That is definitely a future that I would like to live in. So we heard now from you as an academic speaking to the importance of including citizens, but now let's hear about the importance of including citizens in academic discussions.
Thank you. I think you have to start when you're asked why is it important to involve citizens. When you're in a position when you have to answer that question, I think the easiest place to start for me is in just acknowledging the fact that these are moral questions, right? And particularly at the global level, the global governance city is often a moral city. And it's, first of all, a question of, you know, why would citizens buy into prescriptive policies that are being presented to them in a top-down fashion. And when you have citizens actually involved in co-creating those policies themselves, then it's much easier to get buy-in. And I think in many ways, it's the need to have sort of concrete infrastructure to involve citizens is very much a response to why people who look like me, young people, are out on the streets right now, because it's inanity to have people who look nothing like us pulling the strings for our futures. And it's when we're able to create those infrastructures to allow citizens themselves to engage in those trade-offs that we're able to have buy-in. And I think it's quite a simple symmetry of you need the plurality of voices who are going to be involved in those transitions deciding and prescripting what those transitions are going to be. And this is, you know, no more clear to anyone else than the citizens who themselves have to become engaged in those transitions of the trade-offs that are at hand and the moral questions that are at hand. And I think the biggest homework for us, so when you ask that question, it's more a question of how for me than of why. Because if anything, I think most young people would bypass the question of why, because it's so commonsensical to us that of course we need to have our hands dirty in co-creating the transitions that we need to make. But the bigger question for me is the how. And I think that's the biggest homework of this generation, to figure out the how and become smarter and more creative about the ways that we're going to engage citizens. For instance, the project that I'm joining you on this panel for, the Global Assembly, is one way to do this, by gathering a snapshot of what the globe looks like. Not, you know, self-selected people who are already activated about climate change, not elected officials. But what happens when you drop 100 pins on the global map at random based on population density? And you have this authentic cross-section or snapshot of the global population come together and look at the science and learn from each other, and what do they plot forward in that setting? And I think one key learning that we've got from this process that speaks to many of the reflections that were shared in the earlier panel is the science is often 2D until you have citizens engage with it and turn that into 3D. And here we're speaking to the need to localize. And I'm sort of reminded of one of the sessions I was observing wherein the members, the assembly members, were looking at a global mean surface temperature graph. And of course, overwhelmed with sort of these shapes that they had never seen before. And one of the activities that we carried out was plotting on a shared mirror board where their great-grandparents would have been born. And you imagine a breakout room of five assembly members joining from five different countries, speaking five different languages, first overcome with a shared sense of, I will never be able to understand this. And then they see where their respective great-grandparents lived on this map, this 2D graph that is being shown to them by our group of scientists guiding their learning journey. And that's the moment when the data becomes 3D, when they start sharing the stories of their great-grandparents and find that, in many cases, their lives are quite similar. And perhaps their lives now look very different, but in 50 years, their great-grandchildren's lives will look quite similar as well, with the catastrophes that are waiting for them and the shared futures they're living. And so it's the need to make it 3D, and we can only do that when we build infrastructure that involves citizens' voices and allow them to add their inputs and lived experiences into the science.
Thank you so much for that. That's a great way to think about it. Taking these 2D plots that we scientists always use and turning them into a three-dimensional real lived experience. For more on youth engagement now, I want to turn to you. And could you tell us, not just, as you said, it's sort of self-evident why it's important that young people be involved, but from the other perspective, when governments are making decisions, why would you argue that they need to hear the young voices, listen to the young voices? What more can you bring to the table to ensure climate resilience?
Yeah, thanks, Professor Hayhoe. Mm-hmm. Before I answer that question, I just want to start with three caveats, if you'll allow me. The first one, I just want to say what an honor it is to be in a panel full of such accomplished women, Hannah, Emily, Susan. I grew up in a household full of formidable women, three older sisters, my mom, and my quote-unquote boss, Fiona, somewhere in the audience, and especially on Gender Day at COP. So I fully understand the significance of this panel. And I also want to thank BASE and partners for inviting me to participate in the Futures We Want projects and to this panel. But I want to also point out that diverse voices are not only important, but necessary. And diversity of thought and the enrichment it brings to discourse, that's valuable currency. And the last thing I just want to say is that it's very uncomfortable for me to speak at fora like this because it goes against all my natural instincts for me to do advocacy and to communicate so publicly because I have a scientific background. But it's becoming increasingly clear that we all have to sort of speak up because on the other side of the spectrum, you know, the fossil fuel lobbies are fighting tooth and nail to destroy our futures. And that's an objective fact. We've seen it this year. Other African advocates, my friends, and the young people out on the streets, it on Saturday and on Monday, what Susan mentioned, it compels you to take up spaces and to communicate the importance of keeping 1.5 alive, keeping this urgency constant, and because a climate-positive future is not guaranteed. We have 10 years to have emissions. That's 7% every year. So. I also want to also give a short anecdote. In 1856, a scientist named Eunice Foote, another formidable woman, did an experiment where she filled an airtight jar with CO2, and she filled another one with oxygen, and she left it out in the sun. And she made an observation that the test tube with CO2 was significantly warmer. So that's 164 years ago. 10 months, 9 days today since a woman warned us of this crisis, and we are still not budging. And a lot of people actually criticize youth about why you're just out on the streets shouting, where are the solutions? But for one, young people are listening to the scientists. That's why they've started climate movements. And that's why we are everywhere. We're on this panel, we are in the audience. And now to really answer your question, so the former Africa Union Youth Envoy, Ms. Aya Cheb, used to speak about this concept. It's called intergenerational co-leadership. And that's essential, especially in Africa, because young Africans don't have access to halls of power. We don't have the resourcing. We're not allowed to attain political power. And the most popular segment of African society does not control its future. And that's a concern. And I think it's a concern because Africa's greatest abundant resource is its young people, you know? And these young people can be put to work to address the externalities of climate change. But it has to be structured in a way that being put to work in sort of like a climate course, something like that, has to be structured in a way that it's fair and it's equitable, and that's, those young people have to be paid fair wages for them to live a dignified life. Because young people often have to deal with unpaid work. I've done years of unpaid work, and I'm sure Susan as well, you've done a lot of unpaid work. But to really specify kind of how young people are on the front lines of this crisis, in my home country in Kenya, the National Youth Service, NYS, was one of the first government entities to be deployed to fight the locust invasion in my country. So young people can serve us, and but they have to be, or we have to be set up to succeed by policymakers reaching out to us. The onus on them to reach out to us and meet us where we are at. And this valuable work must be compensated. And just to give two examples of young people being on the front foot and being climate leaders, YANGO, which is the official UNFCCC youth engagement constituency, submitted its global youth statement to the UNFCCC. That was a 70-page document, and they want youth engagement to be included in the COP26 cover decision. The Africa Youth Initiative on Climate Change conceptualizes African youth position on climate. So young people are self-organizing. I don't understand the criticism. And, you know, we'll take the future into our own hands, being led by scientists like Dr. Emily and yourself, and the science you generate, and with policymakers who decide to face this crisis, but as well as without them, if they should fail to act in our interests. So thank you.
Thank you so much for that. Now, let's bring in the next piece of the discussion, which is policymakers. So policymakers can serve as a bridge between the leaders and between the citizens who are calling for action. And what specific role can policymakers play in this?
Well, thanks so very much, Catherine, and what a pleasure to join you all today on Science and Innovation Day. I'd actually really love to touch on the young people, the engagement of civilians and young people in specific, because I think it's a really, really important point, particularly given that, speaking from the United Arab Emirates, we've put ourselves forward to host COP28, and we'd very, very much want to work, certainly with colleagues from Egypt for the African COP next year, and onwards towards COP28, which will be essential, as this will be the first global stocktake, and we want to make sure that that's truly global and truly inclusive. But what I want to start with, though, is that oftentimes when we talk about engaging young people, we talk about how they will lead in the future. But I think what we're seeing quite clearly, and especially after hearing our colleague Jebrian and other colleagues on the panel, is that young people are already leading today. We're already seeing solutions proposed on a scale never seen before. We're seeing clear choices made from careers to campaigning. And we are seeing, actually, a growing base of data that shows that climate action yields better results than inaction for policy, for our economy, for our society as a whole, and that direct citizen and youth involvement actually strengthens all of those benefits. So when we think about COP28 from the UAE perspective, we very much are very proud that it puts youth engagement very much at the heart of our presidency, as well as sort of teasing out opportunities and figuring out how we can build a future where really young people can thrive and not just survive. So really figuring out the economic models and what it would take to create that future, but also in encouraging delegations to include youth in their formal delegations at all COPs, and to point and build on Susan's question. Of how really we can move to include. Some of the things that we're doing domestically is mandating youth participation in policymaking. Our Minister of State for Youth Affairs was appointed when she was 23 years old and is still a member of cabinet. We've put in place actual quotas on boards for youth involvement, as well as and mandating the inclusion of youth in all kinds of policymaking, including our National Climate Change Plan, as well as most recently the work in the accelerator model that we had, which brought together federal and local entities to start to look at building our net zero strategic initiative, which for us is actually a call to action to the world. We're a young country, which is not just in terms of the majority of youth in our population, but just as we turn 50 this year. And we're hoping that for the next 50 years that we're able to build a sustainable future that's based very much on net zero. So to go more into more detail, hopefully onto this concept that we've been speaking about today, which is the hope and the opportunity that we see through science-based policymaking and through climate action. Our vision and experience back home really is that climate action is transformative, and we've heard this word earlier today, and it's someone that we certainly share. It can strengthen the economy, we believe. It creates jobs. It raises the quality of life. But that depends on the decisions that we make here in Glasgow, and it depends on what informs those decisions. So we've heard many times that the science is now conclusive on climate action. What we would like to see very much more of as a country that's in the business of building hope, in line with what's been said earlier, is to inspire people through hope and economic interest and spotlight science that evidences the positive impacts of climate action. So, for example, innovations in agriculture and renewable energy that support growth and jobs. The things that you'd want to do regardless of climate benefits. Also innovations that help people to cope with climate change, such as drought-resistant seeds, solar panels that can withstand hurricanes. We're doing a lot of work with IRENA and with partners in small island developing states on anticipatory finance. So how can we make sure that the data, extreme weather becomes more frequent, it also becomes somewhat more predictable. So how can we make sure that we're channeling funding and solutions to places that need it before disasters strike? And moving back for a moment to the agriculture innovation point, this is one of the reasons that we partnered with the United States in looking at the agriculture sector and how we can come together. And we're very honored that earlier this week or last week, we launched the Agriculture Innovation Mission with 30 countries and over 40 non-governmental partners that with an initial investment commitment of $4 billion to channel funds into the agriculture, into research and development and innovation in agriculture, and really see how we can create a step change in the sector, in our food systems, in how we're sort of creating jobs and feeding the future of the planet. So of course it'll come as no surprise that our region is hot and water is scarce, but we do think that that's actually an opportunity to understand better climate resilience and to understand better how we can create a new model of development. The last thing I want to say really is perhaps, you know, a concrete example of how scientists are working on climate resilience. Our Minister of Advanced Sciences is also the science lead for our Mars mission, and this comes back to the word hope, because that's what our Mars mission is called. It's the hope mission to Mars. And this is really one of the key scientific objectives of this mission is to understand what it took for Mars to become the dusty planet that it is. Like, so to understand the atmospheric changes and also to understand resilience. One of the reasons that there was reluctance at first to deploy wide-scale solar energy in the UAE was this understanding that, well, it's a dusty place, and therefore it wouldn't be very very efficient. However, in developing the technology for the Mars mission, we found actually that it's actually quite quite possible to develop panels that can withstand dust. And now, you know, we are home, you know, fast forward a few years later, we're home to three of the lowest cost single source, largest single source solar sites in the world. So additional benefits do come in both ways from these missions. We also just want to bring back the need to work closely with scientists on dispelling myths, on understanding opportunities, and on making sure that this work is inclusive. We're very proud that that over 60% of our STEM graduates are women, and over 60% of the team on the Mars mission are also women. And most of them, I think the mean age is 35 or 39. So that's something that we look forward to continuing to share with other regions and to bringing more hope into these policies. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I love that the involvement of youth is mandated in your process. And it's so interesting because you brought up the exact word I was going to follow with, which is hope. So over the last 5 years, I noticed that wherever I was speaking, whoever I was speaking to, it could be at a university, a community group, a group of business people, young people, senior citizens, every single place I was speaking to, I would receive the same question. And that question was, what gives you hope? So I turned the question around. I use polling software often in my presentations where I can ask questions of the audience. And so I asked them, hundreds of people, what gives you hope? And being a scientist, I collected the data and I analyzed it and I organized it. And I found that the number one answer to that question was some variation of young people, the next generation, my own children, my grandchildren. So then I sat down and I said, why is that? Is it because you think they will fix it for you? And every single person I spoke to said no. It's not that we expect them to clean up our mess, in essence, but rather they are what give us hope. They are the future. And it reminded me of a novel that was written by P.D. James called The Children of Men. You might have read it or you might have seen the movie set here in the UK. It's a society where a global flu pandemic has swept the world. Sound familiar? And as a result, people can no longer have children. And the hopelessness that pervades that society is impossible to forget. As one of the characters says, it was reasonable to struggle, to suffer, perhaps even to die, for a more just, a more compassionate society, but not in a world with no future, where all too soon, the very words justice, compassion, society would be unheard echoes on the empty air. Youth and young people are the future. They embody the future. They take us into the future. And what does that future look like? I'm going to go off script here for a minute and ask each of you a question. If you could picture that better future, what is it, one thing that would make you most excited about living in that better future? It could be something big or something very small, something that changes in your life or your city. Give us an image of what that better future looks like for you. And since I'm putting you on the spot, whoever has the idea first is welcome to go.
Would you like to go first? No, I think it's literally, it's about living in greater harmony with nature, you know? And I think that actually the power of nature, you mentioned, Catherine, the pandemic and the sort of dismal world that we've been living through, all of us globally during the pandemic. But the one thing that has provided hope, I think, for so many people has been our ability to still connect with nature. And so if we can, in that better future, create a future where we are living in greater harmony with the world that sustains us, where we're protecting and restoring our natural habitats at the same time as creating a better society for all of us to live in, then that would be a hopeful future.
Yes, it would. Thank you so much. Susan.
I think for me, the hope is that my children and the children of my generation are in a world where they have the conditions to innovate off of the better futures we've created for them. And I think I'm thinking about this a lot today, especially that innovation is a privilege. And it's particularly young people who understand this. I'm here today talking about an innovation in global governance through our project because of the innovations my parents and their generations accomplished in Korea in fighting martial law and their student protests. And it's those innovations that created the conditions for me to then stand up and live my life currently saying we can continue to move past beyond electoral democracy or things that my parents' generations fought for. And it is this natural cycle of creating conditions where you enable the people who come after you to continue iterating off of the work that you're doing. And it's not going to be possible unless the work we do in our generation creates those conditions for the people who are going to come after us. And so my hope is that we don't break this completely commonsensical cycle of enabling the people who come after us to continue improving the work that we've done.
Thank you. So living in harmony with nature, being able to continue to innovate for good. What else embodies a better future for you?
Yeah, I think for me, I want to see indigenous peoples and local communities in position of actual credible power. Mm. Because I often think about how holistically they used to live in their societies, their communities, and how so extractive our economies are and how we're interacting with natural systems. So I realize that indigenous knowledge, and I fully recognize the role that indigenous knowledge could play. So my hope is in indigenous peoples.
Beautiful, thank you.
Thank you. Well, as a serial multilateralist, I have to say that it's international cooperation, right? So so a future where we achieve absolutely nature, innovation, inclusion, but effective multilateralism in a way that is inclusive of civilians, of youth that we've mentioned, of women, that empowers, I think, the greatest minds and the greatest opportunities that comes from innovation, and really allows us to find truly global solutions and truly impactful global cooperation is what brings me hope. And I think that platforms like this are a step in the right direction, absolutely. Thank you.
Nature, innovation, inclusion and cooperation. Isn't that a world that we all want to live in? And this is really what this event embodies. That's what the marches and the protests that we have seen embody. The enormous diversity of people by geographic location, by culture, by background, by heritage, by age, by gender. We are truly a living example of how climate change is an everything issue. Thank you so much to all of our incredible panelists for participating in this event. I could listen to you all day. I really could. I would encourage you, if you want more, look at these two reports, these two projects that you saw the short videos on, the risks that we face and the futures we want. You have the information on our panelists. Look up more of what they have said and what they have done online. Today, we truly live in a global society where you can find everyone online. Look for more and share what you have heard. Every single one of us has the most powerful force, our voice. The only way the world has changed before is when individual people, ordinary people, raise their voices to advocate for change, to explain why something mattered and what we can all do together to fix it. So whoever you are, whether you are in this room, whether you are listening online, you have a voice. And using that voice is the catalyst for the change to the better future that we have heard about today. We can all do it, but we can't do it alone. We must do it together. We're all in this together. We all share this home together. This issue matters to all of us. We all face the risks together, but this better future will help us all. Thank you again to our panelists for this amazing discussion. And finally, to close this event, I want to introduce the UK Minister for Business and Industry and Net Zero Industry Champion, Minister Rowley.
Well, good morning, everybody, and good to see you all. Thank you very much for coming this morning. It's a pleasure to be here to help close this event, and thank you to Professor Hayhoe for facilitating the discussion and to all of the panelists for their contributions. It feels appropriate as we're here in Glasgow to discuss how science can help us to reach net zero. This city has given the UK some of our greatest scientific minds whose inventions and discoveries have shaped the way in which we live, from Sir William Ramsay, who discovered inert gases, to Professor Robert Edwards, who co-established the world's first IVF clinic. Science has the power to change the world. But as we heard today, to tackle the greatest issue of our time, we have to do science slightly differently, coming together to pool our knowledge and to learn from one another, ensuring research reaches those who need it, and making sure that the solutions we create are effective. As a scientific community, we must come together to respond to the IPCC's clarion call. We need to ensure the importance of what we face is understood by our populations and by those who lead them. Throughout the pandemic, we saw scientists and governments working more closely than they had ever done before, and we have the opportunity to see that collaboration once more. And so, as the COP26 presidency, the United Kingdom is pleased to announce a new coalition of scientists and international organizations committed to changing the way we talk about climate risks to world leaders to raise climate ambition. The initial members of this coalition include the World Meteorological Organization, the International Science Council, the World Climate Research Program, Future Earth, Chatham House, and Woodwell Climate Research Centre. And they will work to ensure that the challenges we face are understood. And to develop a climate risk assessment by COP27 that informs more effective climate policy across the world by working together across borders and sectors to analyse and present climate risk information differently. We also heard today, loud and clear, that how scientific evidence can assist us in how we should respond. Unlocking insights on how we can live and prosper in a changing climate and showing that the opportunities the green transition has to bring about the future we want. The COP26 presidency has placed science and innovation at the heart of this summit, raising the voice of academics globally and championing the knowledge, the insights, and the perspectives of different groups around the world. Later today, in the United Kingdom's pavilion, we will discuss how climate research can and should support Indigenous communities to determine their own future. And in that spirit, I am also pleased to announce today that building on the success of the Futures We Want collaboration, we are launching a new project to leverage the power of science, innovation, and citizen participation to support the development of robust long-term strategies over the year of the United Kingdom's presidency of COP. Working with Italy as our presidency partner, this new project will bring together countries from across the world to share and build our understanding over how we can better mobilize global academic expertise and citizen participation to help tackle specific net zero challenges. I'm delighted with the interest that we've already had in this project, and I look forward to formally inviting countries to join this collaboration in the coming weeks. Science and innovation can provide the solutions, but we can also go further to demonstrate a positive future for all of our citizens. The projects we have announced today will help us come together to unleash that huge power of science and innovation to tackle global climate change and to build a cleaner, more resilient world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Minister, for those remarks and for that important announcement. Thank you, everyone, for attending, and thank you most of all, one more round of applause, please, for all of our incredible panelists. Please don't forget the other events later today that focus on gender and science. They're all available in your programs, and have a great day.